Messiah and the 70 weeks. John chapter 1, verse 35 and 36. The next day, this is John the Baptist, who came to prepare the way for Jesus. And he came baptizing and telling the people of Israel, repent of your sins. Repent. He stood with two of his disciples, and he was looking at Jesus as he walked. And he said, behold, the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. John the Baptist said, that's the Lamb of God. We need to check this out. Who is the Lamb of God? And so they followed him. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah, which is translated in Greek, the Christ, which simply means the anointed of God. The next day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, follow me. This was another one of Jesus' disciples. And Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Let me ask you a question. Were the disciples looking for Jesus? He is looking for some of them, yes? But after he found them, they went and said, we have found the Messiah, which means that they were expecting the Messiah at this time. There was an expectancy of Israel. As we go through the rest of these scriptures, we're going to see that. There was an expectancy in all of Israel. The men that Jesus called were expecting the Messiah to come. Take a look at John chapter 1, 19 through 23. Now this is the testimony of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, because John was a wild man, he was dressed like an Old Testament prophet. The Bible says he wore camel's hair, and then he had a very simple, and he a long bearded guy out in the middle of the Jordan, yelling, telling people to repent and confess of their sins. It was not very Roman, or it was a very Old Testament prophet thing to do. And so all the people would come to John, and he was baptizing them, and he was rebuking the leaders of the day. He rebuked the Pharisees. He rebuked he even rebuked Herod. And he was baptizing. And so the leaders of the Jewish nation, the church at that time, came, and they sent messengers, and they had a question for him. And they said, who are you? He confessed, but he did not deny, but he confessed, I am not the Christ. I am not the Messiah, because John knew that that's why they were asking him. So they asked him, what then? Are you Elijah? Malachi chapter 3 and 4 said that Elijah would precede the coming of the Messiah. And he would make straight the path. And so they wanted to know, are you the prophesied Elijah? Are you the promised one that will show us who he is? And John knew what they thought, because the Jews thought very literally. They were not expecting someone to come with the same ministry that Elijah had. They were expecting literal Elijah to return. That's what they were waiting for. And John says, I'm not literal Elijah, guys. Are you the prophet? In Deuteronomy chapter 18, you can read that Moses prophesied that there would be a prophet like me who would come up. And that was a messianic prophecy, We looked at that on night number one, all the parallels between Moses' life and Jesus' life, and how Jesus and Moses had probably over 20 or 30 things where they were parallel. Moses said that somebody will come, and he's the one you're supposed to listen to. He is the Messiah, and he will be like me. They asked him, "Are you the prophet then?" He said, "No." So they said to him, "Then who are you, so that we'll know how to answer those who have sent us? What do you say about yourself?" And so John said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord.'" He was quoting from the book of Isaiah. Were the priests, let me ask you, were the priests and Levites looking for the Messiah at this time? Well, they were not, they had their idea of what the Messiah would be, right? They were looking for a deliverer from the Jews. They weren't looking for a spiritual deliverer from salvation from their sins. But they were looking for a Messiah. They were. Mark 1, verse 14 and 15. "Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" What did Jesus mean when he said, "The time is fulfilled"? What time is fulfilled, Jesus? What time? When Jesus speaks, if he says the time is fulfilled, it must be that the Old Testament scriptures had given a prophecy about when he would come on the scene. Jesus' life appeared to be, you'll notice, you know, there was a time when Jesus' brothers came to him and says, "Are you going up to this feast?" And Jesus says, "It's not my time. I'm not going right now." He did go later, but he disguised himself. He did not go with the throng because he knew that if he went with the throng, his crucifixion would come too early. There was a schedule that Jesus was on. Over and over in the Bible, you find him saying, "My hour is not yet come." They were about to kill him and throw him over a cliff one time. There was another time they were about to stone him. You can read this in the book of John. And what happened was he passed through them at one point, and it says, because his hour had not yet come. There was a timeline that Jesus knew and understood that he needed to fulfill. And he was walking according to that timeline. And that timeline takes us back to the book of Daniel. How did the disciples know that there was a Messiah expected? How did the priests and Levites, beside from the fact that there was a wild man out in the river of Jordan baptizing people, and everybody was going to him, they also knew. You know what, when Herod came to the wise men, he says, "Where will the Messiah be born?" Because the three wise men had come from the east, and he called the scribes and the priests. He said, "Where will the Messiah be born?" They knew the scriptures. They said, "He'll be born in Bethlehem." And so, as the wise men left and they went to Bethlehem, he told them, "When you find him, you come tell me." He didn't want any competition. But an angel warned those men, "Do not return and do not tell Herod where this boy is." And so God preserved Jesus' life. But there was a timeline. When Jesus was finally born, the Bible says this, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a virgin. When the fullness of time had come, there's nothing that catches God by surprise. He knows the end from the beginning. He knows what's happening. He was the one who gave all the prophecies of the Old Testament about how Jesus would come, about when he would come, what his mission was. And yes, the Jews were looking for a Messiah, but they had a different idea about what he should do than what God had revealed. Go to page 2. I want to talk about some issues in the book of Daniel. There are a lot of people today who don't believe Daniel was written Daniel claims to have been in the very court of Nebuchadnezzar. He claims to have served Nebuchadnezzar all the way through the first of the Persian kings, which places him in Babylon in the 5th century B.C. And scholars today, they see that, they read that, and then they see the prophecy that Daniel lines out, and they say to themselves, there's no way a 5th century Jewish man could be able to tell the future. He must have lived in the 2nd century BC. And writing this from already pretending that he was in the past. But you know, Daniel knew things that we didn't know about the Babylonian Empire until just some of the things as recent as 3 years ago. For a long time, people did not believe that Belshazzar was the last king ruling in Babylon. They knew it was his father, Nabonidus, who was the last king. But they did not know that his son was in a co-regency ruling. That is why Daniel chapter 5, the king makes the promise to Daniel. If you can read this, what's on the wall, you will be third in the kingdom. Because his father was first. He himself was second. But we didn't even know from archaeology, from history, the name of Belshazzar wasn't written anywhere. And it wasn't until late in the 18th century that they actually, 19th century, that they actually found remains and bricks and edicts with his name on it. Daniel lived in the 5th century just like he claims he did. But there are some issues with the book of Daniel. There's a lot of people who don't want Daniel to be true for various reasons. The Babylonian Talmud. The Talmud is the Jewish oral history. It's the oral history that was written down finally. And according to Jewish tradition, Daniel was not a prophet. They did not esteem Daniel as a prophet. As a matter of fact, I want to take a look at this quote. This is from Talmudic Law. And there's a curse here written on anyone who studies the timeline of Daniel chapter 9. It says this: may the bones of the hands of the fingers decay and decompose from him who turns the pages of the book of Daniel to find out the time of Daniel 9, 24 through 27. May his memory rot from off the face of the earth forever. Why would the Jewish leaders pronounce a curse on someone studying the timeline from the book of Daniel? Very, very interesting. You know, Josephus, he was a Jew himself. He wrote in the first century the antiquities of the Jewish people. He wrote a history. And he tells us that at that time, Daniel, in the Tanakh, which is in the Hebrew scriptures, he was among the prophets at that time. In other words, the book, in our Bible, we have arranged the first five books of the Law of Moses. The next book, the histories of Israel. The books following the Psalms, and then we get into the prophets. Well, the Hebrew scriptures have three main divisions. It's the Law, the Torah, the Nevi'im, the prophets, and the writings. And Daniel, at one time, Josephus says, was in with the other prophets until sometime later when they pulled his book out from among the prophets and filed it with the writings because they did not consider Daniel a prophet anymore. Daniel chapter 9 points to 27 AD, the very moment when Jesus was baptized. And because the Jewish nation was looking, they were looking for a Messiah of a different character, of a different nature. They rejected the Messiah who came to them. And they pronounced a curse on anyone who tries to look up at this time and understand it. Because they did not want people converting from Judaism to Christianity. Look at Matthew chapter 24. This is Jesus' words. This is him speaking. He says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let me ask you a question. Did Jesus Christ himself consider Daniel a prophet? Yes, he did. Jesus knew the timeline of Daniel, and he was fulfilling it. He was walking in it. We're going to study that timeline tonight. I need to give you a little background on Daniel and Daniel chapter 9 so that you can understand some of the things that perplex Daniel. Because of sin, the Jewish nation, God had made them a promise. He said, listen, if you walk in my ways, if you keep my commandments, if you obey my word, then you will be blessed above all nations. You can read in Deuteronomy chapter 27, 28. Your kneading bowl will be blessed. Your crops will be blessed. The fruit of your womb will be blessed. Your children will be blessed. When you go out against your enemies, they will be destroyed. They will flee. But God warns, he says, if you break my covenant, I will destroy you. You will be cursed in your house. You will be cursed when you make bread. You'll be cursed when you go, you'll go out to fight your enemies, you'll go out one way, and you'll flee seven different directions. If you break my covenant, if you do not keep my word, if you do not obey me, then I will scold you. I will teach you. We have to do that with our children, don't we? When our children are too young to be reasoned with, when they're going for the stove with their hand, they want to tell, what's that glowing red thing up there? I want to touch that. You've got to take your child and you've got to swat them. They have to learn. Otherwise, they're going to learn a lesson that's going to leave them a scar for the rest of their lives. Or if they play in the street, it's going to end their lives. That's what God is doing. He says, look, I don't want you to experience the final consequences of sin, so I'm going to step in and bring in arbitrary consequences until you learn, until you understand, so there's still hope for you. And what had happened in Daniel's time was this. Let's read it. Open your Bibles to 2 Chronicles. First and Second Kings, First and Second Samuel, First and Second Kings, First and Second Chronicles. Chapter 36, the very last chapter. And we're going to look at verse 15. Actually, we're going to start in 14. This is what the Bible says. Moreover, yes, 36:14. Moreover, all the leaders and the priests and the people transgressed more and more according to all the abominations of the nations. To all the wickedness that the nations were doing, they brought that right into their homes and they did those same things. According to all the abominations of the nations, and they defiled the house of the Lord, which he had consecrated in Jerusalem. And the Lord God of their fathers sent warnings to them by his messengers, rising up early and sending them because he had compassion on his people. And on his dwelling place, the Bible says, but they mocked the messengers of God. They despised his words. They scoffed at his prophets until the wrath of the Lord arose against his people and there was no remedy. Then verse 17 says, therefore, God brought against them the king of the Chaldeans, the king of Babylon. Let me ask you, who was it who destroyed Jerusalem and the temple the first time? God used Nebuchadnezzar to destroy it, but who was really responsible? Think about this. If the people of Israel had not transgressed and closed their ears and mocked the messages and turned their hearts away from God, Jerusalem would have stood to this day. It was the people of Israel themselves because of their continual sinning, because of their continual persistence. You know what you can say? You know, your kids will say this to you. I said it to my parents. I'd get in trouble. I'd do something wrong. They'd ground me for 2 weeks. And I'd say, you guys are just so unfair. It's not right. 2 weeks is too much. But you know what? Who was responsible for that 2 weeks? It was me. I can blame them for bringing on the judgment, but I'm the one who's really responsible at the end of the day. God had promised them, if you're faithful, if you walk in my ways, if you walk in the word, if you keep my commandments and love me with all your heart, I will bless you and you will not be able to receive it. But because of transgression, because of sin, they destroyed themselves. And so they found themselves, 800-900 miles away from home. Because the king of Babylon came and he surrounded Jerusalem and he broke the wall down and he destroyed the temple, Solomon's temple. No other edifice has been built that was more beautiful than Solomon's temple. It was the most magnificent building that man has ever made, and it was dedicated to the glory of God. It was the house where he himself dwelt, and he let it be razed to the ground because his people were sinful and they would not turn and repent from their ways. So he sent them into Babylon, and the Bible says that he sent them there for 70 years. They were captive in Babylon. In Daniel chapter 8, Daniel's been in Babylon for 58 years. He's been there for 58 years, and he receives a vision from an angel, from God, and then the angel comes to explain what that vision is. And we're not going to look extensively at it. Let me just tell you about it. The vision shows the Medes and the Persians coming on the scene after Babylon. Then it shows the kingdom of Greece coming next. And then it shows another very sinister character that we're going to study in depth more as this goes on. But during the time of that, the reign of that king, Daniel sees that the vision says that the sanctuary is going to be cast down, that the people are going to be trampled upon, and that God's sanctuary and his name are going to be thrown in the dust. And Daniel's sitting there thinking to himself, God, we've been here for 58 years. Our city is in ruins. The temple is burned. Your face is not shining on the mountain that you brought. You put your name there, that's where you wanted to live among us. And your face has not shone upon that place now for 58 years. And you know how long the vision said? That at the end of 2,300 days, that the sanctuary would be cleansed. At the end of that vision, Daniel did not understand. The Bible says he did not understand. He didn't know what that vision was about. Take a look at page number 3. This is where we're going to pick up. Daniel 8:27, the very last verse of Daniel 8 says this, "And I, Daniel, fainted, and I was sick for days afterward. And I arose and I went about the king's business. I was astonished by the vision, and no one understood it." Jerusalem was already in ruins. The temple had already been destroyed, and God's people had already been captive for 58 years. And he just got a vision that this was going to continue till for the better part of 2,300 days. And a prophetic day is a year. And Daniel's going, "You mean this is going to continue for 2 millennia? He did not understand. So in Daniel chapter 9, he began to pray. He fasted and he prayed. Daniel 9 verses 1 through 3, "In the first year of Darius," by the way, this is 11 or 12 years after the vision of Daniel 8. Because it was the third year of Belshazzar when he received that vision. Belshazzar's reign was only for another 12 years, 11 or 12 years, and then it was Darius. And so this is 12 years after he received the vision. How many days are in 12 years? How many days in 1 year? 365. You take 365, you multiply by 12, you get over 4,000 days. The vision that he had in chapter 8, he said that they said that the temple would be cleansed after 2,300 days. And so 4,000 days later, Daniel's saying, "We're still in Babylon. The temple is still in ruins. Jerusalem is still destroyed. What is going on?" And so he went back to the scriptures. which is what we must do anytime we don't understand what's going on. In God's timeline, in His estimation, we need to go back to the Scriptures to understand these things. And so this is what it says. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus of the lineage of the Medes, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, Daniel understood by the books the number of years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. And then I set my face toward the Lord God to make my request by prayer and supplication with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. In Daniel chapter 8, they'd been in captivity for 58 years. This is 11 and a half to 12 years later. The 70 years are almost finished. But you know what? Daniel doesn't sit back and say, well, God prophesied it. It's going to happen. I don't have to do anything. You know what God had said? He said, when I drive you into other lands, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and repent and confess their sins, then I will bring them back to their land. And so that's exactly what Daniel did. He humbled himself before his God. And he began to pray. Chapter verse 16 tells us his prayer. O Lord, according to all your righteousness, I pray, let your anger and your fury be turned away from your city, Jerusalem. He was praying for Jerusalem. From your holy mountain, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people are reproach. Who is he blaming for the destruction of Jerusalem? We are responsible. He's taking, you know what? Daniel was one of the most righteous, holy men in the Old Testament. And he wasn't righteous by his own merits. He was righteous because he had a connection with the living God. But you know what? This man bowed before his God and he confessed his sin. And he said, Jerusalem is in shambles today and it's our fault. Verse 17, now therefore, God, hear the prayer of your servant and his supplication for the Lord's sake. Cause your face to shine on your sanctuary. The presence of God, the Shekinah glory, had long been gone from that holy mountain. In Ezekiel chapter 8 through 10, we will study that later, we find the presence of God, the Shekinah, the glory, leaving the temple. The glory of God, we see it come to the doorstep, to the threshold of that temple. And his chariot, Ezekiel sees this in vision, his chariot comes down, the glory of the God of Israel mounts the chariot, and he leaves that place desolate and empty. We're going to have a whole night, tomorrow night, on, well, it's not going to be tomorrow night, it's going to be yet a few nights off. I'm very mixed up in this whole thing. Verse 18, O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city which is called by your name. For we do not present our supplications before you because of our righteous deeds, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and act. Do not delay because we're sitting here tortured in Babylon. Is that the reason he presents? No. He says, do not delay for your own sake, my God, for your city and for your people who are called by your name. You know what? You ever hear the prayer of little children sometimes? They pray for exactly what they want. You ever heard a little child pray for candy? It brings a smile to your face, and you realize they don't understand what prayer's for. But you know what? We pray for candy all the time, don't we? If we would start to pray with God's glory, with His name, with Him to be exalted more, He would hear our prayers. He would answer. But we too often, we pray, Lord, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do at the end of the month. And you know what? God feeds the sparrows and He will feed you and me. But if we learn to pray according to His glory and we have his glory in mind, he will hear, he will answer, and he will magnify his name. He will do that. We must learn to pray like Daniel prayed. Daniel tells us, while I was still speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people and presenting my request, my supplication before the Lord my God, while I was still in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen at the vision at the beginning, which vision? The vision of chapter 8. The one that I'd seen in chapter 8, he was caused to fly swiftly and reach me about the time of the evening sacrifice. And he informed me and spoke with me and said, "Oh, Daniel, I have now come forth to give you understanding. Because at the beginning of your request, at the beginning of your supplication, the command went out, and I came to tell you, for you are greatly beloved. Therefore, consider the matter and understand the vision." You know what? Daniel they'd been in captivity for 58 years. He saw a vision that said 2,300 days and then the sanctuary is going to be cleansed. He confessed at the end of chapter 8 he didn't understand that vision. And then 12 years later, after over 4,000 days had passed and the temple was still sitting in ruins, he began to seek God and say and ask for understanding. And the angel comes to give him understanding of those 2,300 days. And that's where this whole prophecy begins. And the angel Gabriel tells him of these 2,300 days, of those 2,300 days, 70 sevens are cut off for your people. In other words, there's 2,300 prophetic years. And God said, and God is telling Daniel, look, the desecration and the desolation of my people, of the sanctuary, of my name and all of that is yet future. The vision you saw in chapter 8 is for the time of my new covenant believers. But let me tell you about your time, because you're praying right now, you're asking me to restore your city, Jerusalem, the temple, the place where I made my home, where I set my name, and to bring the captives home. So I'm going to tell you the timeline for that. Of those 2,300 years, by the way, 70 sevens or 70 weeks are determined. That word there is shatak, which means cut off. And the question is, cut off from what? It's cut off from the 2,300 days, the vision he did not understand. So 70 sevens are cut off for you and for your people and for your holy city to finish transgression, to make an end of sin, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness. Now there is only one man who can accomplish all of those things. Sinful man can never make an end of sins, finish transgression, make reconciliation for iniquity. That word there, make reconciliation, you find the very same word. Write this in your margin. I didn't have room to give it to you. Psalms 79, verse 7. Psalm 79, verse 7 says this: "Help us, O God of my salvation, for the glory of your name, and deliver us and provide atonement for our sins." Provide, that's the same word that's here as reconciliation in the Hebrew. It's the same exact word. Provide atonement. Jesus Christ is the only one who can atone for the sin of man. Amen. Those four verses speak of the work that Jesus Christ, the coming Messiah, would do and has done now. 70 weeks are determined for your people to seal up vision and prophecy. What does that mean? To seal up vision and prophecy can also be stated to fulfill prophecy. Who were all the Old Testament prophecies about? We studied this on our first night. All the prophecies. Jesus said to those two disciples that were walking to Emmaus, he said, everything that's written in the law of Moses and in the Psalms and in the prophets concerning me must be fulfilled. If you want to write a verse down on that, let me give it to you. Where'd it go? Ask me afterward. Evidently, I can't find it. Number four, the fourth thing there, to anoint the most holy. In the Hebrew, kodesh is the word for holy. And when it says to anoint, it says the kodesh kodeshim, which is the holy of holies, was to be anointed during this 490-year period. And we're going to take a look at that in a little bit. And then he says this, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command, from the decree, when it leaves the mouth of the king who will issue it, from the decree to restore and to build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there'll be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. And between now and then, Daniel, the street will be built again, the wall, even in troublesome times. And this is the very apex, the very center of the message. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah will be cut off, but not for himself. Whose sins was Jesus Christ cut off for? It was for our sins. You can read that, Isaiah chapter 53. Write this in your margin there. Isaiah 53 verse 8 says this, he was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people, he was stricken. Let me just tell you a little bit about what this structure is here. It's called a chiasm. It's called a chiasm because the Greek letter chi is like an X. And it just means as you're building towards the center, the center idea is the most important, which is why it takes center position. But so you'll have an idea here, which you might call A, and then B, and then C, and then D, and you get to the heart at E, and that's the central. But then as you come down from that, each one of those parallels that come out, they connect to the one that A, the very first thing that's said, has a parallel in the very last thing that's said. Let's take a look at that. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city. But what happens after the 70 weeks to the holy city? On the wing of abominations, in other words, as sin increases, there will be one who comes and makes the city desolate. Even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. This is, the angel says, you've got 490 years for you and for your city, for your people. But after that, it's going to be destroyed. Take a look at the next one. Jesus is the one who's doing this finishing transgression, making an end of sins, bringing atonement for iniquity, bringing in everlasting righteousness. The next one there says, in the middle of the week, this is the 70th week, in the middle of that week, he will bring an end to sacrifice and offering. Now, this is a verse that has confused people. Let's just go in order. 26 is the very central. That's where we left off. The next verse says, and the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. And we have to make a decision at this point. The people of the prince who is to come, who is this? There are some people who say this represents Titus, the general of the Roman armies who came and destroyed Jerusalem. But let me ask you, in the context, the prince who is to come, have we seen a prince who is to come before this? Verse 25 says, until Messiah, the prince, doesn't it? Might this be Jesus? There's more evidence that it is. Let's deal with the time frame of this prophecy. The 70 weeks. The angel told Daniel, 70 weeks are determined for your people. And from the going forth of the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince. There'll be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. You take that, you add that up together, 7 weeks and 62 weeks is 69 weeks. 69 times 7 is 483. So from the time of this command to restore and to build until Messiah the Prince is going to be 483 years. There's actually four commands that went out to rebuild Jerusalem from the Persian kings. The first one actually was actually not a command to rebuild Jerusalem itself, but Cyrus said, build the temple again. So the first one doesn't qualify. The second one, the temple work had come to a halt. You can read these things in Ezra and Nehemiah. Those two books describe these things. The temple work had come to a halt because there were men that were allied together against God's people. They did not want to see this thing done. And so they wrote letters and they told the king, listen, do you know what these people are doing over here? You better stop them because this people's rebellious. And if they finish this work, you're not going to get any taxes out of them. And so there was an edict that came back from a new king. He said, make them stop. There was a second decree that came out that told them to again start building again. That was the second decree, but it mainly had to do with the temple. There was a third decree, and this third decree is actually the one. Let me give you some. Take a look at verse 25 there in your notes. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and to build. To restore, the word is shuv in Hebrew. Let me give you a verse for that very word. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 34. 1 Kings 20, verse 34, there's two kings, and one of them says to the other, listen, you know what? My father took some cities away from you in battle. I'm going to restore them. I'm going to give them back. They're no longer going to be under my reign. They're going to be restored to your reign. And so that word there is a technical word that implies restored governance again. The Jewish people were going to have the right to govern themselves again. Not only was there a decree to rebuild, but there was a decree to have their self-governance. And in Ezra chapter 7, the third decree, that is the one that identifies. Because at the very end of that time, Artaxerxes I, he says, Ezra, you are a scribe of the Most High God, teach the law, and you restore, you bring back God's law, and you have the right now to punish anyone, to exercise Jewish authority again. I give you that right. It was the third decree of the four Persian decrees. It was the third that fulfills this prophecy. And that happened in 457 BC. And so 483 years forward brings it to 27 AD. Now don't get confused. There is no year zero. In all of our brilliance, we somehow overlooked that, I guess. 2 BC, 1 BC, there's no 0 BC. It goes straight from 1 BC to 1 AD. So when you cross that line, you have to remember to add a year or subtract a year. I don't remember. You can figure it out. But 27 AD is where. What happened in 27 AD? This is the question. Until Messiah the Prince, the word Messiah means anointed. Write this verse down right there on this text, Acts chapter 10, verse 36 through 38. This is what it says. This is Peter. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word you know, which was proclaimed throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit. Remember after Jesus came up from the water at his baptism, what did John see come down and rest upon him? It was a dove. It was the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove. That is exactly what Messiah means. Anointed one. That is the, not that Jesus didn't have the Holy Spirit. We know Jesus had the Holy Spirit from the womb. Because the angel had told Mary, the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And what will be brought forth from you is a holy child. But especially in a public declaration, in a public declaration before all the people of Israel, God wanted everyone to know that this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And it was the testimony of John the Baptist that told them, you know what? He who sent me to baptize told me that on whom you see the Spirit descend, it is he who will baptize with fire, Jesus Christ. He fulfilled that. And that happened in 27 AD. You know what? Open your Bibles to Luke chapter 3. I want to show you this. Luke chapter 3. God's word is so precise. Luke chapter 3. Look at how verse 1 starts off. Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea, and the region of Tachonitis, and Licinius, tetrarch of Abilene. Do you really think that was necessary, Luke? Why would we be, why, you know what it goes on to describe here? The ministry of John the Baptist and the baptism of Jesus Christ. Why would the author of the book of Luke give us, how many are there? Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, Herod, Philip. There's at least five governing people here that he gives us. And it's the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar. Why? It's because prophecy was being fulfilled at the baptism of Jesus Christ. And Luke wanted everyone to know and have a nailed down date for that. Amen. The Word of God doesn't just say things for no reason. You know what? If you go on the internet, this is one of the reasons why this topic is so complicated and so difficult sometimes to teach. Because all the records of Roman history are all written in Latin. And there's only a couple of historians from the Roman time that wrote about Augustus and Caesar and all of these things. And if you go on the internet and you go to Wikipedia and say, all right, I want to know what was the first year of Tiberius Caesar, they will tell you it's 14 AD when Augustus died. Tiberius was adopted by Augustus because Augustus' male heirs all died off by 4 BC. They were poisoned or they died from natural causes. I don't remember all the story. But they all died off. And so Augustus was left without an heir. And so he adopted Tiberius. But you know what? 2 years, I want to show this to you. 2 years before Augustus died, which would have been 12 AD, he asked the Senate to confer upon Tiberius equal power with him, where he would be absolutely equal. And the way that we know this is because of archaeology. Marcus Agrippa, the husband to Augustus, who was the daughter of Julia, he died in 12 BC. And so Tiberius, being loyal to Augustus Caesar, actually divorced his wife and married the daughter of Augustus. He was granted a degree of power, tribunician power in 8, and Gaius and Lucius, which were the two heirs that Augustus was looking to receive the kingdom after him, they died by 4. And this is a verse we've already looked at. Many modern sources will place the beginning of Tiberius's reign in 14 AD, some of them in 13. I've got a whole list of historical references I would be glad to share with anyone who wants to know and understand these things. When Augustus, his adoptive father, died, that would make the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar 29 AD. But archaeological evidence in the form of coins minted during his reign revealed that he was on the throne in 12 AD. 2 years before Augustus died, the Roman Senate voted Tiberius to be co-ruler of the province with his father, Such an arrangement is called a co-regency, Nabonidus and Belshazzar. But he was granted by the Senate equal power with Augustus, which would make him emperor in 12 AD. When you add 15 years to that, you come right down to 27 AD, the very moment when Jesus Christ was being baptized at the Jordan by John the Baptist.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. This 70th week has perplexed a lot of people because they've taken the 70th week. There's a lot of bad stuff. You go down and read the last of this prophecy. You see, there's going to be desolations until the end of the war. You see that there's going to be abominations and one who makes desolate and all of these things. Really bad stuff decreed. And people just automatically assume that that's speaking of an antichrist. And since nothing bad happened to Jerusalem at the end of this 1 week, they say, well, let's take that week and put it way down at the end of time. That week must be cut off somehow or go away, or there must be an antichrist that comes and rules for 7 years. But would that make... What if... It doesn't make any sense. God said, all right, look, Daniel, after 70 years, I'm going to bring you home. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you, there's like 2,000 years between the 69th and the 70th year. You're going to be stuck there for another two millennia. God doesn't work that way. Let me help you. If you have some of these ideas in your mind, let me help you try and understand what's going on here. Take a look at this. Verse 26, the second half of verse 26, and the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. We already read in 2 Chronicles 36, God brought Babylon, the king, but who was responsible for the destruction of Jerusalem? It was Israel. It was Israel who was responsible. They can blame God. You did this. You sent Nebuchadnezzar to come destroy us. Even, did we read in the prayer of Daniel? Who does Daniel say was responsible for the first destruction of Jerusalem? Israel. The people of the prince who is to come. Who is the prince who is to come according to this prophecy? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ's people, the Jewish nation, are the ones who are responsible for the destruction of the city and the destruction of that temple. And the end of it will be with the flood. You know what? Notice how that parallels with verse 25. The angel came and told Daniel, he told him this, listen, there's going to be 7 weeks and 62 weeks until the Messiah of grace comes. But you know what the people of Israel did when Jesus came? He was standing before Pilate, and Pilate presented, he said, behold your king. You know what they said? We have no king but Caesar. Think about that. How much did the Jews hate the Romans? Wouldn't it have been painful for those words to even come out of their mouth at any other time? We have no king but Caesar. If Jesus had said that during his ministry, they would have stoned him on the spot. Right? But yet in their hatred for this man who was holy and blameless and pure, they were willing to say, we have no king but Caesar, to see him hang on a cross. And you know what else they said? They said, his blood be upon us and upon our children. Amen. And those words were registered in the books of heaven. Amen. And you know, as Jesus was going to the cross, there were women crying for him. And he said, daughters of Jerusalem, don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. Because if they do this in the green, what will they do when it's dry? Jesus says, all these things will come upon this generation. We're going to study that in the Abomination of Desolation presentation. You don't want to miss that. It's related to this. Verse 27, the 70th week of Daniel chapter 9, he will confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. You know, Jesus, when he sent out his disciples, he says, listen, do not go to anyone except the house of Israel. when he was in Tyre and Sidon, and a Syrophoenician woman came, "Please heal my daughter. She has a demon, Jesus." Jesus said to her these words. He says, "I was not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." The covenant that's confirmed in that final week, you have, if you don't, I think you do have the verses, Isaiah 42, verse 6, and Isaiah 49, verse 8. God there says, "I will give you the Messiah as a covenant to the people." You know, there's 296 occurrences of the word covenant, bereshith, in the Hebrew, and not one of them refers to a covenant that an antichrist makes with the Jews. Every single time it's used, it's a covenant between God and his people, between God and his people. Every single time. Check me out on that. The covenant that is confirmed during the 70th week is Jesus Christ himself. And it says in the middle of that week, he will bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And you know what? The Jews continued for another 40 years offering their sacrifices and their lambs. But in the eyes of God, the veil was rent from top to bottom by an invisible hand. And God was saying, no more will the blood of a lamb, which could never take away sin, be called upon to take away sin, because the blood of my Son, Jesus Christ, has come. And you know what? Verse 24, the most holy, the Kodesh Kodeshim, the very center of God's salvation, was anointed, inaugurated with the blood of Jesus Christ himself. When Jesus Christ returned to heaven, he spent 40 days with his disciples, and then he returned. And on 10 days later, on the day of Pentecost, there was an outpouring of the Holy Spirit like nothing that had ever been seen before. And what was happening in heaven was the holy temple in heaven was being inaugurated to service. If you read Exodus chapter 40, you read that the first temple was inaugurated. Moses went through it, and he, with blood and with oil, he, before anything had ever been slaughtered, before anything had ever been, he anointed each altar, the table of showbread, the Ark of the Covenant. It was anointed before it was ever used. And in the course of time, Daniel said, during these 490 years, the true sanctuary with the true blood of the Lamb and the Spirit of God will be anointed, and that sanctuary will open up for business, and it will begin to cleanse the sins of my people. Hallelujah. The prophecy of Daniel 9 pinpoints with precision exactly when Messiah would come, exactly what his work would be, and he would confirm that covenant with many for 1 week. Pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, for its power and its precision. Father, help us to study these things out. Lord, you are awesome. You are amazing. You are our God, and you have sent Jesus Christ as a covenant to keep covenant mercy with your people, with us who are sinners. By his blood, Father, redeem us, wash us from our sins, and draw us to your side. In his name we ask these things. Amen.